dear respected Thai, dear friends, dear Sangha. The summer retreat at Plum Village every year is a special time. It's a celebration of life. It's a retreat for families, for children, for teenagers, for young adults, for older adults. It's for everyone. And Thai has always wanted the summer retreat to be a festival. And that is why every week we do have a festival. And tonight we'll have the Rose Festival, where we will remember our parents, and you will have an opportunity to share your memories, your appreciation, your gratitude to your family, your mother and father, your adoptive parents, people who took care of you. And we'll also listen to the text that Thay wrote about his mother and father. It's very beautiful. That is why we have different celebrations every week. Next week it will be the full moon festival, and then the final week of the summer retreat, it will be the celebration of peace, the peace festival. When we're able to live in the present moment, we're able to participate in celebrations, because our mind is free. We're wholly present. We can be in touch with the beauty of life. When parents come, they notice that their children are very happy, and their children immediately make friends. And the friendship is very joyful to see. The children are friends right away. And they make friends with children from many, many countries. And the parents also make friends. And there's a bonding, an affinity that parents have in talking to other parents. And children have this affinity with other children and teenagers as well, and and young adults. So it's a time to find friendship, to find support. And this is support of people who are practicing mindfulness, who want to practice mindfulness. Sometimes in our daily life, we cannot always find these conditions. And we can, of course, we can create a little sangha or go to sanghas close by. And this is also very nourishing for our practice, to have others practicing along the same path of awakening, of compassion, of love, of peace. So this is what the summer retreat is about. For us monastics, we look forward to it. We prepare for your coming. We go shopping and buy the food to prepare the meals each day. And I was told that we're close to 1,000 people. So the sisters are cooking 300 meals times 900 meals a day. And the brothers are cooking for 500 people times 3 meals, so 1,500 meals a day. And that is, it's a miracle. It's a miracle of mindfulness. And that we're together and there's a collective energy that we can feel, we can sense the energy while walking, the energy while eating with our smaller families, the energy of just being together without having to do too much. Of course, we're in smaller family groups, and that gives us more of an opportunity to experience a family unit that practices. And we share from our heart during the Dharma sharings. It's very beautiful. So the summer retreat for many of us is a very nourishing and supportive time for our practice. It doesn't mean that everything is all roses. That is an expression. It doesn't mean that everything is all lotuses. It doesn't mean that it's always so beautiful. And we know that the lotuses grow from the mud. And Thay has said that a lotus cannot grow from the marble. We know a lotus cannot grow from a piece of wood. A lotus cannot grow from sand or cement. It really needs the mud. And as we look at our lotus ponds everywhere in all the hamlets, we know that they're messengers of beauty. They're messengers of peace. They're messengers of love. To see a lotus bloom is to watch something miraculous. And we can watch the lotuses bloom. You can go to the lotus pond in your hamlet and choose a lotus bud. That means it hasn't opened yet. It's just in this closed shape. But look at that lotus day after day and watch it. You may talk to it if you wish, and then invite it to bloom. You can send your energy of love and peace to this lotus you have chosen. Send your loving kindness to this lotus that hasn't opened yet. And see what happens. Yeah, I think the lotus will appreciate attention from 1,000 people. Because sometimes we just walk around. We just look at it or we take pictures. That's good. But to actually have a connection with the lotus is also wonderful. It's possible. Well, we know the lotuses grow from mud, as I've said. And when I say life is not always lotuses, that means perhaps during our time here, we've touched a deeper layer of ourselves. We could call it the mud, our mud. That means it's the part of us that has not yet become a lotus. You could say it may be the part of my mind that still has my irritation, my impatience, my anger, my fear, my anxiety, other mud elements. My depression, my despair. We sometimes refer to these elements in our consciousness as the mud. This week the theme is mud and lotus, so that's why we talk in these terms. We know in our consciousness that the deepest layer, the stored consciousness, contains all the seeds. All the seeds, which are really experiences that we've had, and they're stored there in a potential state. But they're also the seeds that have been transmitted to us by our parents and our grandparents, and all of our ancestors have transmitted experiences. And all of these experiences stay in the depths of our consciousness. The way all of the lotus roots, the roots of the lotus flowers stay in the mud. They don't jump up and down. They don't fly around. They stay there. They sleep. So all of these seeds in our store consciousness, called bijas, they stay in a resting, latent phase. And all is well and good. But if it happens that we receive some experience in the present moment, it could be by what someone says to us, or a look, or someone's action, then we receive this sensory impression all the time during our waking hours. Our eyes are open, our ears are open, we smell, we taste, there's touch. So all of these sensory organs are always receiving input. And what happens with the input is that it goes to the depths of our consciousness, and it can wake up the seeds that are sleeping. So that's actually what happens when we get angry, for example. Right now, I don't think many people are experiencing anger. It's because your mind is listening to something. Your mind is paying attention to the words. But if someone were to come up to you and do something, or sometimes this happens in the family. The children, if you have many children, they have a lot of energy. And they come up to mommy or daddy all at once and they're talking. Everybody's saying something else. And maybe mommy's cooking and the phone is ringing and all the kids are talking and want you to do something. Well, that's going to water all kinds of seeds in your store consciousness. Many seeds will wake up. They will jump up and they're going to manifest in the level of your mind. And you may feel an emotion. First of all, you just may feel, oh, it's too much. You may just have a feeling, like before you know what's happening, before you've been able to name what's happening. Your body tells you it's too much. Okay, a feeling is there. The seeds have woken up. Many seeds jump up at once. So maybe anger has manifested. And when a seed jumps up or swims up or walks up to the mind consciousness, then it's called a mental formation. And mental formations have names. So it could be at work. There's too much happening and you've just been asked to do one more thing, too much. So that has woken up a seed, and that seed has come to the level of your awareness, your mind consciousness, and you can call that stress. But if we look into stress, stress is made of non-stress elements. This is how we look at life in Buddhism. We don't see things as separate entities. We see everything as made up of many, many elements. This beautiful orchid plant is made up of non-orchid elements, such as the earth, where the roots are, the earth, the water, the sunshine, the air. This is true of everything. The lotus flowers in the ponds are made from non-lotus elements. Again, the water, the mud nourishing the lotus plant, the air, the oxygen, the sunshine, the rain. And we're also made of non-me elements. We're made of mommy and daddy. We're 50% mother, 50% daddy. And then we can continue to look deeply. Mommy was made from her 50% her mother and father, and daddy was made from 50% his mother and father, and it goes on for generations. But our life is possible also because of the air, the sunshine, the food we eat, the earth. So many elements contribute to our life as well. So we say that the seeds that manifest, the anger, for example, is made of non-anger elements. The stress is made of non-anger elements. So what shall we do to discover what these non-anger elements, non-stress elements are? This is important in our daily life, to be able to recognize what is happening and how it has come to be, so that we can do something to change the situation, if it's a situation of suffering or distress. But we also want to mention and underline that we're also talking about happiness. It's not just anger and suffering, but happiness. My happiness also is made of non-happiness elements. The singing of the children, the presence of all the retreatants, our friends, the sunshine, the green grass. So we look deeply to find, to identify what these things are. Maybe the stress is made from the fact that I didn't have enough sleep last night. Maybe my stress is made from the fact that before I left for work, I didn't have enough time to say goodbye to my children. Or my partner and I, we didn't have enough time to hug one another. So we try to find what it is that has contributed to what I'm experiencing as stress. What we do when we notice that we feel stress or anger is that we practice the stopping. We just stop. And we can do that in a very easy way, so people will not be upset. We just stop and you can smile, so that if you're with someone, if you're at school and you're a teacher and you're feeling stress in the classroom or stress with your colleagues, you feel it, your body's telling you, your body is becoming tense. Just stop and smile. And then I think many of us know what we should do. We should just come back to ourselves and breathe. So why don't we try this now all together? We're going to practice to be ready for anything that may come up when we return home. Because we have the practices now. And now we're just training ourselves. We're creating the neural pathway, this new neural pathway. And the more we practice it, the stronger it is, and it will become stronger than the old pattern of reacting with stress. So this is why we really enjoy stopping and breathing here, to give us this strong neural pathway of transforming stress and creating peace, happiness, and relaxation. So let's listen to the sound of the bell, and we'll all practice together. So the practices are pretty easy. They're pretty clear, straightforward. Someone said that the only problem is we have to remember to practice them. But if we practice them long enough, they become a habit. And then it's just our habit. For example, we create the habit of walking, meditation, every time we walk. It becomes a habit after a while that we simply feel our feet touch the ground. Our awareness automatically goes to our feet touching the ground, and then we let go of the thinking while we walk. So this can become a habit, that we bring our awareness to our breathing also when we walk, that we let go of the thinking. So this phrase, let go of the thinking, is found in a lot of our practices, because the thinking takes us away from our mindfulness energy. We're so involved with trying to solve things, find solutions to reduce our stress. We think we can reduce stress by thinking enough. But we found that the best thing to do is to let go of the thinking. Calm and relax the body and let your stored consciousness that contains all of the wisdom, all the experience of your whole life, your parents' life, your ancestors' life, it's all stored there. So we want to give this wisdom a chance to help us. And the way it can help us is if we stop the non-stop thinking. But you know, it's not so easy. Why is that? We have the telephone, the portable, this portable telephone. It's important, of course. But it means that at any moment of the day, if it's on, someone can call you and you'll pick it up and you'll start talking. So talking is part of a global culture right now, and it has its benefits, of course, for emergencies, for very important messages, contacting family. It's very important. So telephones have their very important function in our life now. One of the things we can recognize is that it has created habits of talking, so that we talk more now. And if you imagine this planet Earth during 24 hours, when one half of the planet is sleeping, the other half of the planet is awake and talking, and then it reverses. That part of the planet goes to sleep, maybe, but we don't know at what time. Maybe 2 a.m., 3 a.m., so there's talking. All right, so then the other half of the planet is sleeping, and then that half of the planet wakes up and begins talking. So 24 hours a day, there's talking on planet Earth. But if you come to Plum Village, what do we tell you? We say, noble silence, please. It's so hard. Why? We give the mind a rest, you know, a rest, especially during the time when we say bedtime. It's probably earlier than what you're used to. We say 9 o'clock, 9:30. It's earlier than you're used to, we know that. But it's to give us an opportunity, at least, just an opportunity to rest the mind from thinking. So what do we do instead of talking and thinking? What is the answer? Breathing, walking. Okay, so we're creating new habits for us to live in the present moment. And when we live in the present moment, we're not caught about thinking of the past and what we suffered in the past. We're not bringing up those seeds from the past that make suffering. Also, when we live in the present moment, we're breathing, we're walking, smiling, singing, living a lifestyle of mindfulness, we're not worrying about the future either, because the present moment is right here. We're looking and we're not thinking about the past or the future, we're just looking. And that's so wonderful. The eyes are open. And we're looking, we'll find someone, there's no worry. So children are wonderful teachers about just being here and now. They're your wonderful teachers. And they have the freshness of lotus flowers. They have a beginner's mind. They always ask questions, they want to learn. So it's very wonderful that they're with us during this retreat. We've been studying the 16 breathing exercises that the Buddha has offered and that have been practiced for more than 2,000 years. And I like to reflect that the exercises have lasted for 2,000 years. It's wonderful. Though the people breathing them have changed, right? New people have started breathing them, and those who were breathing them are no longer breathing them, but maybe breathing them in a new way. But the breathing exercises have lasted, just as walking meditation has lasted, hasn't it, since the time of the Buddha. Though the feet have changed, right? The shoes have changed. There has been change. We recognize, we accept, and appreciate impermanence. But within permanence, we can see continuity, a continuation of the 16 breathing exercises, the full awareness of breathing, the Anapanasati Sutra, and other sutras the Buddha has given that are still practiced, still continuing. So if you'll permit me, we can continue. I'll do a little bit of review, but we have some new ones to learn about. Numbers 9, 10, and 11, and 12. And what I hope to do is to share when and where we can practice these. Because if they just remain sentences on a board or in your notebook, then they're not too helpful. But if we can learn where and when to practice them, then that's more inspiring, I think. So we can enjoy our breathing as I try to dismount from the platform. But I'm grateful it's not moving. Then it would be a horse more difficult to dismount from. Very briefly, I'll go through the ones we've already been learning about in the first 2 weeks. The first one is to identify our in-breath and out-breath. So I experience breathing in, I experience breathing out. And we've experienced this during the guided meditations. But this is a very interesting one. We can take it with us when on departure day. If some of you are departing tomorrow and you will find yourself at the airport, they now have, we all know, security, the check-in lines. Depending on when you arrive, the line may be short or long. So this is what you can practice as you're waiting in line with your suitcase to go through security check. I'm aware I'm breathing in, I'm aware I'm breathing out. You may want to add a few more breathing exercises during the security line wait. I'm following my breath. That means I'm going to give more concentration to when my in-breath changes to the out-breath. I'm concentrating. When my out-breath will then change to the in-breath. This is a nice cycle. This will give you more concentration. As you're standing in line, maybe you'll become aware of your body. Maybe you feel tired and you wish there were a chair in the line. But there's no chair in security line, so you can move your feet and do some of the 10 mindful movements. So you have Plum Village practice with you at the airport. If you are waiting for a few hours for your connection, you can actually enjoy walking the long corridors in the airports. I think Madrid had the longest airport we've ever seen, but I haven't been to many. But you can see if the airport you're at is the longest airport for walking meditation. It's enjoyable. And you can say it's longer than the walk we did in Upper Hamlet. It's longer than the walk we did at New Hamlet. So you have the memory of Plum Village with you, of course, and you continue your practice. Calming my body. So where do we want to calm our body? That's if we really feel stress. Okay, I don't know if this will happen at some point in your travels. Calming the body, that means your muscles are tense. So we recommend find a chair and sit down. Sit down, relax. It could be that everyone is hungry, the children are hungry, and there's tension, and you don't want to be late to be at the departure gate, so you have to move a little bit faster, and maybe you have to do mindful running to get to the departure gate, so you arrive. Okay, find a chair, sit down, calm your body with mindful breathing. Breathing in and breathing out. So these just some suggestions of finding places where you can apply it. Of course, we know here at Plum Village we have the food serving lines, don't we? Are there any lines, food serving lines in your hamlet? Okay, so this is where we can actually. We can prepare ourselves for the airport. We practice mindful breathing on the food serving lines now, and then when we get to security check or passport control, it'll be very easy. We'll do it very easily. Just some ideas. Okay, the next two we know are, we're going to bring experience feeling joy and feeling happiness. So if you look at the lotus flowers and you love the lotus flowers and you smile when you see the lotus, you'll notice that this is a feeling of happiness I have now. I'm feeling happy. If you like to sing and you really love to sing, and after you finish singing, if you feel happy or maybe you feel joyful. This morning there was joy as we sang. There were the feelings of joy. So whatever activity or sounds, water the seeds, these seeds in your consciousness of joy and happiness, when we notice it, the joy and happiness will increase. If you plant a garden and you see the little vegetables start to grow, that's the feeling of happiness, of joy. The life has begun. feeling joy and feeling happiness. So today and tomorrow even, make a note. What brings me happiness and joy? And then we really feel the happiness and joy. If we don't feel any happiness and joy, let's go to the next two. It's called aware of a painful feeling. And then we're going to practice calming a painful feeling. So the Buddha thought it would be a good idea for all of us to prepare ourselves before looking or recognizing, embracing a painful feeling. And this is what Thay has taught us, that if we can bring a little joy, experience a little joy, then we're much stronger to be aware of a painful feeling and calming a painful feeling. A painful feeling can come from our body. We have a backache, a toothache, or it can come from our emotions. I'm aware of some sadness. I'm aware of some stress. But we haven't named it yet, okay? The Buddha is taking us very gradually and gently through this process of living every moment, living different situations in our life with mindfulness. The first four, just be with our body, relax our body. The next two or two, create a feeling of joy. Call someone up that you love, receive a telephone call, whatever that you know will be joyful for you or happy. Happiness is very good also. Joy has more excitement and happiness is more like a stream of refreshing water. I'm so happy to drink this refreshing water. Okay, and then Buddha feels, all right, we're ready now to acknowledge a painful feeling. Because sometimes that's the hardest thing to do, is to acknowledge that we feel some pain. And we don't have to name it. That's the good thing. It's the gradual method. I just feel, oh, something's not right. Or that interaction left me with something not pleasant. We can just say it that way, not pleasant. Not a pleasant feeling. The Buddha said that the feelings themselves are of three kinds. And we can have a pleasant feeling, and we would probably, these are the pleasant feelings, but we can also have painful feelings. And then the third kind is a neutral feeling, which is where we are most of the time. It's not really pain, not really pleasant, but neutral. And with mindful breathing, we can make a neutral feeling be a pleasant feeling. So, aware of the painful feeling, now, right away, after awareness comes practice, okay? After awareness comes embracing, which is practicing, okay? I am aware, I embrace, I practice. There are also smaller steps. I'm aware, I embrace, I accept. This is practicing. But practice, we can also mean I will practice a mindfulness practice, such as mindful breathing and mindful walking, to help that feeling change. So this is what we mean by calming a painful feeling. We missed the train. Oh, example. We hope that doesn't happen here. We hope we do our best. I don't think it's ever happened. Or there's a train strike. There's a plane strike. That does happen. You have a painful feeling. That means you cannot be at your job interview. Oh, a painful feeling. Mm. I recognize it, I accept it, I embrace it, and now I'm going to practice something to help that energy transform and change. So, and it will happen if we practice. We've learned that it's not enough simply to say, I'm mindful that I have an unpleasant feeling and leave it at that. We found it's not enough. Remember when you first arrived, there was the orientation. And we talked a lot about the practices of mindful walking, right? Practices, mindful walking, in, out, out. I have arrived, I have arrived. I am home, I am home. This is what we mean when we say we practice. I have arrived, I am home. I'm living in the present moment with this feeling. I'm not going to run away from it. I won't run in, I won't look for chocolate or whatever you like. I won't try to cover it up. I won't try to consume. I'll be with it, but I'm not alone because I have the practice with me. The practice is my friend. So my walking and my breathing, my painful feeling will be a happier feeling because I'll be practicing. So the practices are simple. They're not too complicated. So we remember the awareness, embracing, transforming with the practice. Shall we practice breathing again? And we'll be really masters on departure day, or masters when we continue for 2 more weeks or whatever. We're going to be really strong with this. Okay, a new neural pathway. So, dear friends, this part of the practice has been called feelings. And what happened is when monastics and the children came up, some of it was erased. So I'll just add. This is feelings. This next section, number 9 to 12, is concerned with the mind, with our mind. The feelings also are concerned with the mind, but this is really more specific, aware of a painful mental formation. Calming a painful mental formation. And so I describe that when someone says something to us or looks at us in a particular way or something happens, maybe our seed of anger has been watered and it will manifest in our consciousness as a mental formation. So the seed of anger was sleeping here, but it was watered by something. Either someone said something, or it could have been by our own thinking. We can make ourselves angry when we think about a situation, when we have a perception about a situation or a person. So perceptions can come from our body, but also perceptions can come from our feelings. So the practice is to invite the seed of mindfulness to manifest and embrace that mental formation of anger, to embrace it, and mindfulness will also mean a mindfulness practice of mindful breathing. And if it's in a situation of anger and two people are there, then it's best to come back to yourself, to not continue the conversation. If two people are in the process or about to have an argument or it's starting, it's best that there be a pause, a breathing pause. And if one person can say, "Darling, I think we're getting upset," it's best that we not talk now, that we talk later. So it's very helpful if one person has the awareness and enough mindfulness to know what is happening and can name it and to say, "Let's not escalate. Let's just each of us take care of our emotions, and then when both of us have calmed down, we can talk about it." So this is the practice of aware of a painful mental formation, okay? And then we calm our painful mental formation with mindful breathing, mindful walking, and then looking deeply. So there's one thing missing called concentrating the mind. Somehow it was not written on the board. The next one is called concentrating the mind. So when we want to concentrate our mind, the best thing to do is to simply have this one aspect that you're going to concentrate on. So it's best to do while you're breathing in and breathing out. For example, I say, "I want to know why I feel angry." Breathing in, I'm going to concentrate to find all the roots and the causes. I'm going to concentrate just on this one thing, to look deeply, to discover what was it? What were the elements contributing to the anger in myself or in the other person? Very often, sometimes anger comes up because people just don't know. They don't know they're doing something or saying something that upsets another person. So you may receive the answer, "Oh, maybe she just didn't know. he didn't know. I'm breathing in and breathing out and concentrating my mind to find the roots, the causes, and also how I contributed to this situation where there's anger. There's another practice, and it's called gladdening the mind. So we've had to look at some painful mental formations that we've experienced, and then we've concentrated our attention. We're not thinking about many other things. We're focusing just on this one as we breathe in and breathe out. And you may do this during a meditation, a sitting meditation, or when walking. You concentrate your mind by just being aware of your feet touching the earth or your breathing. So these are concentration practices, and mindfulness and concentration will help you understand. It's called insight. The next stage is called gladdening the mind. So the Buddha has encouraged us then to make our mind happy. We've spent some time being aware of a painful mental formation, such as anger or sadness. And we've practiced to calm this immediate feeling of anger or sadness or jealousy. We've practiced, and then we've concentrated our mind to find out why. What is going on? Can I find the elements, what I have done to contribute to it? Can I understand what is going on with the other person? And then the next stage, the Buddha thought it would be very good if we then took another turn, a pause, so to speak. Let's try gladdening our mind now. So we spend time with our suffering, okay? We may want to call this the mud experience. The mud experience in our relationships, the mud experience with ourself, our habit energies, the fact that sometimes we react, we get upset, we don't speak kindly. So we're aware when our reaction comes up and we speak that way. We're not able to listen. We judge, we blame, we criticize, we find fault. And anger can be very, very subtle. It doesn't have to be a full out, blown out expression of anger. It can be very, very subtle and not expressed verbally, but it can be expressed in different ways. So, we've done our best to find the causes, the roots, and now the Buddha says, let's gladden our mind. So for that, we want to think of experiences and events that we've had that have brought up the seed of happiness, because we're working on the level of the mind now. So we all have seeds of happiness, appreciation, gratitude, love, peace. We'll gladden our mind by thinking of these experiences and these situations. There was no conflict, so we think about an experience where there was harmony, there was love, there was peace, no conflict. Maybe you'll reflect on Plum Village, something you liked about your stay here. So you may want to write down your list before leaving of what gladdened your mind while you were here, and you bring that list home, and after you look at your calm your painful emotion, then you have your list of gladdening your mind. Some people like to listen to music that gladdens their mind, or some people enjoy weaving, pottery, hobbies, gladdening your mind. And then for the monastics, what we have each year is called Shining Light Letter. And maybe our friends, you also have a yearly evaluation from your work, and they say very positive things about how you are doing. Or you have letters from your beloved ones, letters from your family, your partner, letters from your children, or very special, precious items. And you spend time with these wonderful experiences to gladden your mind. For the monastics, we have the Shining Light Letter, and the first part of the letter, it is an expression of the positive qualities we have. So the Shining Light Letter, the first part at least, guaranteed to gladden your mind. The other part of the letter gives encouragements, how we can improve our practice or our weaknesses, but that's also helpful. So, and the last part is called liberating the mind. So it's a process that we're going through. It's not done at one sitting. Please don't give yourself the expectation in 25 minutes we'll go through the whole thing. No, we don't recommend that because the result may not be what you want. But through this continual practice, by recognizing the mental formations of suffering, embracing them, recognizing the relationships that we have where there's not always harmony, where we're causing suffering to one another. If we practice with ourselves to recognize what is it that I'm expressing, what seed from my mud is manifesting that causes suffering to someone else, I'm aware of it, and I will calm it for the sake of harmony in the family, for my children's sake. I'm going to calm it. I won't talk if we're angry, but I'll concentrate my mind on what my role has been. And then I'll take a break. I'll gladden my mind. We go to the park with the kids, or we eat ice cream. Wow, whatever. Gladden the mind, but we don't have to consume. We go to the beach, whatever, nice. Gladden the mind. And then you'll experience liberation of your mind. You're not caught in these patterns of reaction. That's the liberation of the mind. You'll experience some freedom. It's a gradual process, but you'll experience more and more freedom from these habitual patterns, reacting, anger, sadness, jealousy, insecurity. These are human. I mean, we all experience it. We look at the lotus pond. The mud is there for all the lotuses. It's not just one lotus has the mud. The mud is universal for all the lotuses. So the seeds of unskillfulness in our store consciousness, we all have them. So don't feel so bad. Everyone, we all have them. You don't feel guilty or ashamed. It's just the human condition. And we want to be aware of the environment that we're in and our children are in, because that's the environment will water the seeds, the wholesome seeds and the not so wholesome seeds. the positive seeds, or we say the negative seeds, beneficial or unbeneficial seeds. So be aware of the fifth mindfulness training, what we consume with our sensory organs, what we eat, what conversations we listen to, how we speak, because how we speak will affect others, will water seeds in their consciousness. So we have the beautiful practice of beginning anew. So we share our appreciation, we make people beautiful lotuses, and we become a lotus when we share how much we appreciate the lovely quality in other people. So the beginning anew is for that, to water the lotus flower in all of us. If we've made mistakes, we can say, I'm sorry. We can let people know what will make us happy, what will make us unhappy, called selective watering of the seeds in their store consciousness. And then we can do our best not to hurt anyone by what we say or our actions. But we know we make mistakes because we don't know. And since we're all practicing together, there's forgiveness, there's understanding. And we know from Thay's teaching, when there's understanding, there's love. There's forgiveness, there's compassion, there's acceptance, and there's a feeling of a liberating the mind. Oh, we've gone through this difficult period together. You can say with your partner, you can say with your roommate, we've gone through it together. Thanks to the practice, we've liberated the difficulties we've had because each of us have practiced this, these practices. So some people have asked how to prepare for re-entry into your daily lives after having been here for a week or two. And you can continue to do what you enjoy doing here, all right? So it doesn't have to be just like Plum Village. You don't have to wake up at 5 and do exercise. And but we do recommend that in the morning that you do some mindful breathing. And we recommend the first 4 for your daily life at home, okay, in the morning. Also at work, you may become aware of your body, then please calm your body at work, whatever is your work environment. We recommend feeling joy, feeling happiness as often as possible. But we can't program it. But you actually, in the computers now, there's something called a silent buddy. It shows you beautiful images from nature. So you can find out more about how to download something for your computer screen. Beautiful, beautiful scenes from nature. Or the mindfulness bell on your computer. Feeling joy, feeling happiness with the children, you know, with your partner. Aware of painful feeling, calming a painful feeling. This may come up if you go to a meeting at work, a board meeting or some challenge. It may come up. It may come up right after a long day at work. Both you and your partner, your spouse, may have had a difficult day, each in your own place, and you come back and both of you are having painful feelings, And then the, maybe the children are adding their difficult day at school. And then when several people have the same emotion ready to manifest, such as stress, irritation, anger, there can be a collision. Everybody gets angry because there's a transmission of the energy of anger. If your seed of anger is just about to surface, it hasn't come up yet, but it's ready. It's been watered. It's a little sprout has woken up, and someone says something, wow, it will manifest. So this can happen in relationships. Two people can be doing their own work or whatever, and then sometimes we don't know our seed of anger is ready to manifest. We don't know that. It just takes the final, we say, a little match to light the fuse of the firecracker. Do you know what a firecracker is? No. Well, that's good, you don't know. Personally, I don't like firecrackers. When I hear them, I get so scared, and then I get angry. So two mental formations can come up together very easily, very quickly. So, but the firecracker image is used because the firecracker has a long fuse, right? Maybe not so long, not long enough, but you light it, and then there's time before the explosion. So sometimes in our mind, it's a little bit that way. The explosion hasn't happened yet. All it needs is that match or the time and pop. So it can happen that two people with the same habit energy of reacting and getting angry, they meet each other and one person says something that upsets the other and there's the transmission of anger. Two people are really angry. So if that is the situation, it's better that one person removes themselves from the situation. Don't stay there and look at each other. It just continually waters more and more and more, escalates. So we practice the, when there's been the two people getting angry at the same time, take time out, look, calm, relax, cool down, find out what I've contributed, gladden the mind by thinking that he's really wonderful. This is just one situation, or she's really wonderful. We're more than this brief episode. But we may not be able to think of that. We may not be able to gladden the mind because we're still angry. Go to the letters, go to the photo album. Try to rewater these wonderful experiences you've had together. And then you'll feel much better and you can do hugging meditation. That's also a practice that waters the happiness and reaffirms the love in the family. And children love to hug. I think most children love hugs. So another thing you can do at home is that you create a room for mindful breathing. And Thay suggested this in the year 2000, and I think many, many homes, many apartments now have a little corner of your apartment or a room, and Thay recommends you have a plant or a flower and a cushion and a little bell, and everybody in the family knows that this is where we go when we have an unpleasant feeling, painful feeling, or when we have a body full of tension and stress, we go to the room, we go to this little corner, and we invite the bell, and we breathe. And then everybody in the family hears us inviting the bell, and they know, Oh, mommy's in the breathing room. Daddy has gone there to be happy. And the children can go there, and it's so healing. It's very healing to have this space. So when you go back, think of creating this space. And make it your way, okay? Doesn't have to look like this, but make it comfortable and pleasant. So this is it's time out. It's a little vacation. Call it what you want. It's a place to rewater your seeds of happiness and love and peace. And some people want to know that when they look at the situation of the world and they read the media and they know what's happening to Mother Earth, how to keep hope alive. How can we continue to have hope for the future, you know? So one of the things that will help a lot is that what Thay has recommended is that we can be aware of what's happening in the world, very important, but we do not overdose ourselves with the media. We don't overdose too much with the news. You know, once a day, enough. And then to practice, we're going to balance now, gladdening the mind. Gladden your mind. Think about that the practice actually is helping many people. We read that 100,000 people have received the 5 mindfulness trainings. So that's very good news, okay? That's hope, that many people are practicing the 5 mindfulness trainings. So when we begin to think that it's hopeless, how can the earth survive? The fact is we are surviving. We're doing a lot, and that everyone counts. So that will give us a continued inspiration to practice and to recycle and do what we can for Mother Earth. Next week, the theme will be Mother Earth. And then very often we're in a situation where we have to make decisions in our daily life. If we're fortunate, we have time to think before we make a decision. So it depends on the nature of the decision. If you work in the emergency room, then you're a doctor or nurse, you have to make quick decisions. But the answers are there already in your stored consciousness because of your training, because of your experience as a doctor. You know what to decide. In other kinds of decisions, maybe involving lifestyle, relationships, the best way to make a decision is to not to feel pressured, but to calm your mind and to let your decision come from the wisdom of the stored consciousness of your ancestors, of your experience, of your Sangha. So this is a broad question. We can't really answer it in general, but there are ways to make the best possible decision. We call on our Sangha. We call on our practice. We practice as we're in the process of deciding. We call on the wisdom of our children, of our friends, and then finally give yourself time for the decision making. So I hope this has been just a little bit of some ways of practicing at the airport, at the train station, at work, online, at the doctor's office, at the bank, at the grocery store. We have many opportunities that are there. At the stoplight, it's an invitation to breathe. So the opportunities are there. So we're going to be a detective. We'll search for these opportunities and discover them. So we're very happy to have shared this week with all of you. We know that tomorrow is departure day. We wish you a very safe and pleasant, a gladdening experience of your practice, of your life, your mindfulness lifestyle. And we hope to see you again. Thank you very much.